Belinda Audio and Zaffa Publishing present this unabridged recording of The Mayfly, written by James Hazel and read by Tim Bruce. To Joe, words are meaningless without you. Men are creatures among whose instinctual endowments is to be reckoned a powerful share of aggressiveness. As a result, their neighbor is for them not only a potential helper or sexual object, but also someone who tempts them to satisfy their aggressiveness on him, to exploit his capacity for work without compensation, to use him sexually without his consent, to seize his possessions, to humiliate him, to cause him pain, to torture, and to kill him. Sigmund Freud, Civilization and Its Discontents. One. December. Post-festivities. The frozen earth was veiled in a thin covering of snow that crunched under Detective Chief Inspector Tiff Rowlinson's boots. In a glade, the log cabin looked as though it had come out of a fairy tale, complete with a tall stone chimney and heart-shaped etchings above the door. A local landowner had built it for his daughter as a summer house 60 years ago. But it had long since been abandoned, and was now swathed with climbing plants and moss. A sanctuary, built out of love and innocence, defiled in the most grotesque manner. Rowlinson slowly circled the little wooden structure, his hands behind his back and his coat collar turned up inside the white plastic overall. The crime scene investigators mingled uncertainly, watching where they trod. They had established a perimeter with reams of blue and white plastic tape around the glade. Rowlinson had been here before. Too many times. He'd seen too many bodies, too many weeping loved ones, and too few prosecutions. He didn't feel much anymore. The endless cycle had anesthetized him. Except in these woods. In these woods, Rowlinson felt again. He approached the entrance to the cabin and ducked through the doorway. Inside, the air was stale and heavy. He fumbled for the inhaler in his coat pocket, felt a little relief at feeling the familiar plastic tube and the tip of the metal canister. He no longer noticed the bitter cold. The room was empty, save for the victim, and the flesh-eating flies swarming around what was left of him. The victim's head was slumped over the back of a wooden chair, mouth and eyes wide open. His skin was yellow and withered, a reaction to the poison, Rowlinson had been told, but he now understood a comment one of the Soko team had made a short while ago. Poor bastard looks like someone sucked his soul clean out. He was naked, and his arms were covered with deep lacerations, but that was nothing compared to his chest. The flesh was hanging off, exposing a crimson network of muscle and tissue. There were similar wounds on the lower half, but everything was so saturated in blood it was hard to make out which parts of him remained intact and which didn't. Jesus! A voice behind Rowlinson gasped. He turned to find Hardwick in the entrance, hand over his mouth. What the hell have we got here, Gov? D.S. Hardwick was a foot shorter than his superior, but still managed to fill the little cabin with his portly frame. He was a city boy with a swaggering gait, but a decent copper despite his lack of charm. The damage is self-inflicted, Rowlinson said quiet. He tore his own skin off, boss. Rowlinson peered more closely. Tireism, excretion of foamy saliva, but to such an extent that the victim had been unable to control it by swallowing alone. At some point, he'd introduced his fist into his mouth in order to induce vomiting, but it ended up biting down so hard that he'd almost taken his hand clean off. The alkaloid caused unimaginable pain for many hours. To combat it, the victim attempted to fillet himself. Why? To get at his heart, Hardwick, It was the only way to end the pain. 3 hours earlier, Sir Philip Wren had been sitting in the study of his Kent home, his belly full of port and chicken, and his mind full of gushing phrases to use during his acceptance speech for an OBE. He had received the phone call only yesterday, in the strictest confidence. The Honours Committee had resolved to acknowledge the incumbent Attorney General's services to the legal profession and Her Majesty's Government in the New Year's Honours List. Finally, a lifetime's commitment to public service was to be recognised, and Wren had spent the last 24 hours in a state of euphoria. But his jubilation had been short-lived, and he was now in South Wales, cold and anxious and with a sharp pain in his head. The scene was, as he had expected, a glade swarming with a forensic team, blue flashing lights, a feeling of uncertainty hanging in the air. And in the centre, a little wooden cabin with hearts carved above the door. It's happening again. He had been told that the detective in charge, Rowlandson, was competent. He had no doubt that this was true, but a local detective couldn't possibly keep this case. Not if Wren's fears were realised. He found Rowlandson standing with another man by the cabin door, looking at him with the same expression of uneasiness as all the detectives he had seen over the years. He didn't blame them. If he could have it any other way, he would leave them to get on with their job, but he couldn't. Not this time. He walked across the glade, conscious of the questioning eyes following him. "Philip Wren." He offered his hand and received a firm grip in response. "DCI Rowlandson, we weren't expecting the Attorney General, sir. Is there a jurisdictional issue I should be?" "Not at all. No one wants to tread on any toes here, Chief Inspector. Your authority is not in question." It was a lie. There was a task force already in place to take over the investigation, a subdivision of the National Domestic Extremist Unit, a covert specialist MET unit. "Then I don't see... May I see the body, DCI Rowlandson?" Rowlandson shifted his weight from one foot to the other. The Attorney General had arrived in a Jaguar XJ, accompanied by a small company of dark-suited men. These men had gathered the bewildered Soko team together and were issuing them with confidentiality agreements to sign. After a further moment's hesitation, Rowlandson stood aside. Wren inhaled the cold air greedily before stepping inside the log cabin. His stomach churned. He didn't want to see that chicken again. Rowlandson stood in the doorway watching him curiously, hands wedged in his pockets. He cleared his throat. "The poison was administered through a catheter in his wrist, probably while he was unconscious. The poison takes over the whole body, arrests every single nerve. The pain is excruciating, but the brain is too overloaded to shut down. The sensation apparently lasts for hours, during which, as you can see, the victim mutilated himself." "Is there anything in his mouth, Chief Inspector?" Rowlandson faltered. "What?" Wren felt a lump in his throat, something restricting his airway. "His mouth, Chief Inspector, is there anything in his mouth?" Rowlandson looked behind him, as if he thought it might be a test, before taking two strides across the floorboards to within touching distance of the victim. The foam around the victim's gaping mouth had begun to congeal, but some of the froth dripped down the side of his face like egg white. Wren watched as Rowlandson peered in. "There's nothing there." Rowlandson straightened up. "Check again." Rowlandson bent over the body again and looked closer. Wren balled his hands into fists. Perhaps Rowlandson was right. Perhaps there was nothing there. "Hang on," Rowlandson said, digging a pen and a pair of blue plastic gloves out of his pocket. "There is something." Wren felt a tension in his body snap as Rowlandson repositioned himself, dipped the pen into the victim's mouth and gently eased it back out. "What in God's name is that?" He held up a black object to the light. behind him. Philip Wren walked swiftly out of the cabin. 2. The 6th of April, 1945. Buchenwald Concentration Camp, Germany. Captain Ainsworth stood outside the main gate, a cigarette clinging perilously to his bottom lip. The rain had let up in the last hour, and sunlight was daring to penetrate the cloud covering. The 89th Infantry Division had arrived 2 days earlier. They had been up for a fight, but instead they had found the camp under the control of its inmates. News of the arrival of the British and American armies had reached the camp a few days previously, and the Germans had begun a hasty retreat. With the command structure dissolved and most of the guards having either fled or committed suicide, a group of inmates had stormed the watchtowers. The plucky inmates, most of them communists, had been hiding weapons for years, which they were now finally able to put to good use. They had even had the guts to take prisoners, showing mercy to the Nazi wardens who had shown them nothing but inhumanity. Ainsworth's men had been ill-prepared for what lay waiting for them at Buchenwald. They'd heard about the camps, of course, and heard rumors of mass killings with gas. A Polish-Jewish lawyer named Lemkin had even coined a new word for it, genocide. But words were so easily absorbed into the skin. Seeing a man so overwhelmed by the relief of his emancipation from a hell on earth that he fell to the floor dead at your feet. Nothing had prepared Ainsworth for that. They had met the Czechs first. Thousands of them crammed into spaces designed for a few hundred at most, stripped naked except for loincloths, freezing, dying. Their bodies had shriveled through malnourishment to such an extent that they barely resembled human beings anymore. The walking dead, with yellowy white skin that tore as easily as paper, stretched so taut that Ainsworth could count every single rib. With their last remaining energy, the inmates had greeted the 89th Division like heroes. So weak they could hardly walk, but somehow they had managed to hoist up some of the infantrymen, lean and heavy lads at that, to parade them around the camp in triumph. Embarrassed but desperate not to offend, the soldiers had reluctantly allowed them to do it, although some of the inmates had collapsed from the effort. They were a mixed bunch, from what Ainsworth could gather. There were the Czechs, but then there were Poles, Soviets, French, Croats. Women, too. Many of them had been forced into sexual slavery in the camp brothel. Perhaps, most satisfyingly for Ainsworth, there were a few of their own. American airmen who had been shot down over occupied France. British, too. The false papers they had carried that were supposed to have helped them escape from enemy territory had backfired. When they were captured, the Nazis treated them as spies and shipped them to Buchenwald along with the Jews. Jews. An entire race the Nazis branded the useless eaters. There was a polite cough. Ainsworth had been lost in his own thoughts, hadn't noticed the corporal behind him. Henderson was a good soldier, and bright for an infantry lad, but, like the rest of the boys, he looked pale and sickly.
"First part of the roster, sir," said Henderson.
He handed over some papers, which Ainsworth took but didn't read. Instead, he gazed over at the horizon, past the battered-down gates and across the yard to where he could see a sign that had been torn from the wall and stamped into the muddy earth.
Arbeit macht frei.
Work sets you free. After a while, Henderson said,
"We don't have enough medicine for these people, sir. We can't stop them dying."
Ainsworth nodded grimly. "If you can't stop the bleeding, that's no reason not to try to stem the..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.